For joining us. We are calling in here from beautiful Gumbengi country, and let's pay our respects to the land that we're joining from. I am Parul, I'm your host for today, along with Drew, who I'll introduce in a minute or pass the mic to. And while we pay our respects to elders of the past, present, and especially the young ones emerging, who are the stars of this show and stars of this life and stars of this planet in general, we pay respects to all First Peoples everywhere and extend our respect to the practices that have sustained life on the planet for many, many millennia and continue to do so today. Now, what makes me who I am today is the deep-rooted spirit or the wisdom that comes from the land I come from in India, the many mentors that walk and cross our paths, including one of my mentors, Drew, who's on this call. Do you want to quickly introduce yourself, Drew?
Beautiful and really, really warm welcome and introduction, Parul. Hello, everybody. It's really great to be here. And probably more importantly, it's great to be in amongst a community that is, yeah, so open-minded and have lots of wisdom to bring to the table. As mentioned, my name is Drew Paten. I'm the co-CEO for A Mentoring this year. I'm a Ghana Kurnai man, and I'm just honestly overwhelmed and also in a state of privilege being able to sit with so much knowledge and great humans.
Brilliant. Today we're going to talk about how do we action peace? How do we take peace, which some people think is an idea in people's mind, and bring it out into life? And the questions we're going to ask of an amazing panel consisting of people from Netherlands, Czech Republic, Denmark, France, Australia, Kenya, South Africa. We're going to go on a world tour in the next 30 or so minutes. But before we do that, I think we will throw to a quick video just to welcome you all to, especially those of you who are new to AIM, to our worlds. And then we'll jump on the flip side of the video to the panel and engage in the collective wisdom on this group call.
PJ, I don't know about you, but that still to this very day gives me shivers. No matter how many times I watch it, it will forever give me shivers. So, yeah, that was really great. So today is a really great opportunity for us to come together. And today we're exploring how to action peace. Now, peace is not the absence of war. It is not the gap that separates two periods of conflict, as many historians say it is. Peace is an active, creative, constructive process that requires daily engagement, an action from everyday individuals, you, me, and we, to bring into the world. It is our natural state that needs nurturing and strengthening through action. And words help, but it's action that really counts. With that in mind, I'm really looking forward to the idea of us as a collective being able to come forward with so many ideas. And we're gathered here with a bunch of really great humans from the Peace Youth Alliance. And so what I might do is throw around the ground really quickly. And within a 30-second period of time, I would love, and it's going to be a little bit of a challenge, but I'd love to throw around to our different panelists and for you to introduce yourself, but what organization you're from, and maybe even give us a quick glimpse into what peace means to you. Ermin, have we got you, my friend? I might throw straight to you. I would love to hear from you.
Hey, Andrew. Hey, PJ, and hello to everybody on the call. My name, as Drew just said, is Ermin. I'm joining the call from Nairobi in Kenya. I am part of the AIM team. I think what peace means to me is really, let me see, how can I put this? So it's relatively early in the morning. Not that early, but it's still early days. So my brain is still waking up. What peace means to me is really how humans understand each other. I think I've lived in about nine different countries in my lifetime. And one thing that I have often been in a position to observe and to witness and to experience for myself is how sometimes people are saying the same thing in a very, very similar, but they're saying the same thing in different ways, and so they're not really understanding each other. And to stand in between that space between people who are trying to understand each other and not managing, and being able to hear both sides and to bring that together, for me, that's part of what makes peace, is that we stand in a gap and we help people to get each other and to empathize with each other and to understand what our similarities are and where we're humans together, basically. And it really, for me, it's not something around nation and policy, but it really starts from within.
Yeah, so true, Ermin. On that note, let's see who else we can build bridges across. Maybe we go from Kenya, Nairobi, over to the Youth Island. Anna, do you want to introduce yourself and tell us who you are and what peace means to you?
Of course, thank you. My name is Anna, and I am an ambassador for the 17 Sustainable Development Goals. And also, I have worked with peace through the exchange organization AFS Intercultural Programs, where the aim is to reach peace through intercultural exchanges. But today I am here to talk about the global goals and how these goals are essential for us to reach a stage of peace. Because to me, peace is a stage where we find ourselves and we find each other's. It is harmony between human beings. But also, I feel like it is a stage where we do not harm each other's as human beings, but nor the planet, because it cannot just be within us. We have to have the planet in the games as well. And that is why I feel like it is so important to also bring the global goals into play, because if we reach these goals, I am sure that this will be the stage of peace as well. Thank
That's
you.
That's incredible and really nice to have you here with us. Wow, there's so many great people we can throw to. How about we throw to Olivia, my friend, all the way over on the other side of the world. I'd love for you to introduce yourself and where you're coming from.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. And I'm Olivier. I work in Paris in a research center called CRI, and I'm co-leading an initiative, a collective initiative called Learning Planet. And in fact, the motto of Learning Planet is learning to take care of oneself, others, and the planet. We work with UNESCO and many UN organizations, but we are looking for a way to tell the story of the SDGs that is even more accessible or understandable by everyone. So this idea of aligning the fact of learning to take care of oneself, others, and the planet seems key in this regard. I think there are two dimensions that are really shared, or values that are shared across all cultures, across centuries, but the dimension which is caring and of fairness. So these two dimensions, if you align them, if you are a world which is fairer, with less inequalities, and if you take care of the others, so this needs to invent new ways of learning, of teaching, of doing research, of mobilizing collective intelligence, and maybe also of working with AI and other technologies. And at the time being, we're working together with the IT teams, the Little Prince of Saint-Exupéry, and hundreds of people, of creating a GPS of dreams to allow individuals to share their dreams for a better world, so that they can have collective dreams, and from these collective dreams to move on to having, utopias, but realistic utopias that we can do together. So I can build on this, but really thank you very much for taking me in this conversation. It's a great pleasure.
Thank you, Olivier. I love the idea of GPS of dreams. Like, how cool is that? Let's build a GPS of dreams together. Let's go back to Youth Island and listen from Aart and Martina. Do you want to quickly introduce yourselves and tell us who you are and what peace means to you?
Hello, my name is Martina, and I'm from MasterPeace Denmark. And what peace means to me is, I think, balance. And connected to that, I think it comes from us and from the effort that we want to make to create peace. And I think that's peace, that we want to put effort to communicate, to understand each other, to create something instead of destroying something else.
Maybe to add, I'm Aart from MasterPeace Global. Peace to mean is action based on inner peace. So inner peace is the driver, and then to contribute and not to extract. And one practical example, I think a few months ago, my colleague Marlene attended a webinar organized by Olivier, and then she was in the same panel as Drew. And what happens? Well, you're open-minded, now we are collectively, and with all the world, there are, let's say, hundreds of events. And so my mission in life is to strengthen the networks of the like-minded, because we have to outnumber the negative.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Martin. I would love to throw to another global connection that we're building here today. Anne-Marie, how are you doing? I'd love for you to introduce yourself to the rest of the crew.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And it's really an honor to be here. And I'm very touched by your movie, also by how we're coming in. But I was very touched by I've looked at it a few times, but it really touches me deeply. And I'm very much dedicated to co-create from the heart and find ways to work together that work for all life, because I really do see and sense that we're all interconnected and interrelated, and that there's also a multidimensionality to our world. And I think that's one of the things that I've sensed that also comes back here. And to see how we can come into a much better balance of the masculine and the feminine, and also intergenerationally. So the interaction between the generations, and also our awareness of the past time, the future, that is all coming together in this moment now, and how can we connect and relate to that, honor that, and serve all life forms. So thank you for having me here. It's very inspiring.
Thank you, Anne-Marie. That's very beautifully put. And I think it automatically builds on what Aart and Martina was speaking before, of like that sense of inner peace, bringing the masculine and the feminine together, bringing the disparate energies at work. And one person I think that does this better than anyone else is our friend in South Africa, Vhutali. Over to you, my friend. Tell us who you are.
Thank you, Parul. It's a It's a pleasure to be here. It's a pleasure to be here. My name is Vhutali. I'm in South Africa. I've been with AIM for quite a while and just working on trying to make sure that everyone's life is as peaceful as we say peace is. According to me, peace is the acceptance that we are part of nature and nature is part of us, and we make peace with the environment we are living in. But in a group setup, I believe peace is the creation of environment where all in the group can thrive, and regardless of color or gender or whatever denomination we can place people on, the environment should be conducive for all to thrive in. That's for me how I see peace. I'm looking forward to hearing more and sharing more about this as we go.
So good to have you here, smiling away, Vhutali. Last and definitely not least, Philip, how are you, my brother? So happy to have you here. The mic is yours.
Thank you kindly, and thank you for having me. I'm Philip, part of City Transformers and the Peace Day core team, also situated on Youth Island at the moment. I consider peace to be a state of mind in which we're able to both share and feel the love and kindness that there is in the world that doesn't really show through until we actually start bringing it towards others. And that is what I strive to do in every action that I take. And I believe why I'm sitting here today, both on this call and on this island.
Yeah, profound, really profound, Philip. And the number of perspectives we've heard already on peace start to form like a crystal view of the different lenses when we look at what a fascinating and beautiful idea peace can be. It's maybe a thought in our minds. Maybe it's an inner balance between two opposing thoughts. Maybe it's how we connect to other people, how we build bridges across different cultures, races, and so on. How are you going, Drew? What's happening in your mind?
I can't seem to get this smile off my face to start with. So I think that's the start of peace, right? Is being able to smile and enjoy one another's company. So I'd love to throw out a question to the crew, if that's cool, PJ. And it's from Donut Economics, and it's, what can you do to help create a world that works for all within the limits of the planet? And have fun while doing so. Now, I don't want to pinpoint people. I'd love to have this the next few minutes as an open discussion. So I'm going to leave that as an open question for anybody to jump in.
I just got to say that I love the addition of having fun while doing it, because we're incredibly focused on this and addressing this burning question throughout this. Yeah, it's also important to enjoy the process. That's certainly something.
I can jump in with one recent experience which brought me to meet some of you also. We're working more and more across the world with youth people on all subjects. So different programs, one program called Children in All Policies. And how do we work with youth councils from different countries and with many to make sure that we co-design with youth all policies that are related to their future. So whether it's health and education and peace and all these dimensions. And doing this at scale, I now start to see cities coming together and creating network to really promote the youth rights and participation at scale. So this is both acting on the ground and making change and doing this with very different youth, and it is a huge pleasure. So it is very meaningful and fun. We call it maybe meaning fun. So that's one way maybe.
Meaning fun. I love that one. Still keen to hear from everyone else on the panel. Unmute yourselves and tell us, how would we create this world that Drew sort of imagined? Anne-Marie.
Yes, I think, we see in the groups that I'm working with, we're seeing cities also. Thank you for bringing that in, Olivier, as living cities, as places where that are coming to life through our actions. And in that, with Integral City and with our work, we see that joy, that deep sense of joy, is really something that helps us also in very difficult times. And joy is not only about having fun, although we're really having fun here on Youth Island, it's also this deep sense of feeling alive. And so how can we enhance that capacity and give ourselves, and also in our educational systems and in everything that we build, that we can all the time feel that life force? And I think even in cities, it's so important that we also bring in nature and bring in other parts of our, not only humans and the buildings and all that kind of thing, but the other parts, because it is just, if you just look at a plant or look at something that has to do with nature, that already helps you to sense that life force. It's a practice, but it's very simple, actually. So that's one of the things that I think can help contribute, that we really come into connection in a different way and have all voices heard in how we form our societies.
Can I add, Drew?
Please, I'd love for you to add.
Let's say the joy part has also, let's say, an element of rewarding, that you really are pleased. And I am most rewarded when I receive a compliment because I give, or not a compliment, but I feel the compliment. So it is a rewarding job to contribute to society. And my main mission in life, I identified some years ago, is I want to contribute, not to extract. And when I took that decision, it was so rewarding. My life became more and more rewarding. And then you sparkle and then you smile. So I think rewarding and joy are two elements of the same coin.
Thanks, Aart. And Martina, while you're still there, what do you think?
Thank you. About the donut economics and like the question you asked, in my opinion, I think we, like, for sure it starts within us, like I said previously, with the effort and the communication. And I think we need diversity, because what I see in the world today is that we are trying to have this ideal, if it's some kind of a system that we are trying to use for everyone globally. But we all know that we are very diverse and very different people, countries, nations, and I think that's what we should start working on, to understand the diversity and try to work together to learn from each other and balance everything that is included in the donuts economics, if it's education or other aspects.
Thanks, Martina. I'd love, Anna?
Yes, please, I would love to jump in on that as well. Because I think it is really important to keep in mind that we need to include the young people also in order for us to keep it fun. Because for the young people, they are longing to learn something new. They are longing to do something where they can really make a change. So I believe if you hand over the ball to them, so they can come up with their ideas, then first of all, they will have the experience of that. They can recognize a problem themselves. They can work on it and they can see it change. This reward is so rewarding as anything can be. And this is what it takes to also have fun, because if it is a learning process and if you can do something new where it is your own initiative, then I think that this is a factor that we need to keep in mind, because then we can move in the right direction. And especially young people, they have this drive to really do something when they set a goal. And then we can have fun along the way while we gain new knowledge.
Sure, and I couldn't agree more. I think like one of the most beautiful things that and rich things that I've been able to see here at AIM is exactly that, is when you place a young person at the front of the stage, or when you give them the power to be able to lead conversation, you start to see a different dynamic on how conversations are laid out. So for part of what we do with INTV, we make sure that the young people are leading the conversations. And often you have this young kid in high school, you know, talking to it or leading a panel full of really great people that have had 30, 40 years of worth of experience in their lifetime. And all of a sudden the power dynamic shifts. And rather than it being a hierarchical thing of because this person has more power or more knowledge, they're more important, it plateaus itself out and everyone is seen as this equal party. And it's just this really beautiful dynamic is when you start to center youth voice at the very front of it. So yeah, thank you for raising that point. PJ, I'm going to throw it back to you, Russ.
Yeah, I'd love to hear. I know we're going to run out of time in a minute, but I'd love to hear from everyone on what practical action are people going to take at the end of this call. What is your pledge? Like, what are you going to make? What change are you going to make in the world as an individual to create a more peaceful and equitable world within the confines of the planet and have fun while doing so? Why don't we start with you, Ermin?
Thanks, BJ. okay. have fun while doing it. That's the part I'm going to focus on a little bit. The most fun I've had recently at work is reaching out to academics, professors at top universities around the world, and say to them, hey, would you like to come and co-author a paper with some of our non-human professors of Imagination University? And our non-human professors, they are made of purple and pink and blue furry hair, and they have these, they're what in this world would be called puppets, but in our world of imagination are called professors, and they're the professors of Imagination University. And the knowledge that they are bringing to the world and trying to share with the world free of charge in monetary terms in any case, is knowledge around imagination, around flipping the script out of narratives of disadvantage, out of building bridges, organizing change. And these are areas that we have at Imagination University, a stream for school students, high school students, to become entrepreneurs of change in their own lives. So to use their imagination and to use their connections and to use their energy and their dreams to design and to co-design the future to start, but to design these change in their own lives, in their communities, and in the world. And it's really fascinating to see kids coming from areas that are not within the margins of privilege and power and influence, who have that imagination and who open it up and who choose to learn. And so that for me is a lot of fun, watching that happen and then trying to bring the more established and very well respected academic world into this space, which is absolute fun and which is absolute, well, 100% imaginative. So yeah, anyway, my pledge on that is just to keep chasing, it's just to keep chasing the academics and bringing them into this world, because we really want to build that bridge. And we've talked about collective intelligence and learning from each other. And so my personal pledge is to, because I failed and I'm learning from failure, I joined Imagination University last year and I dropped out because I just didn't have the time to take my pledge forward. So what I'm pledging to do is to learn from all of these young people who have been so 100% into creating change for themselves. And I'm going to learn from them how they stuck with it in the commitment and the learning and all of that. That's my personal. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Emin. I want to throw two more people before we close out. Vhutali, I would love to hear from you. What's your pledge moving forward?
Thank you, Drew. I did enroll on Imagination University for the project, but my project was specifically meant to give, and I wanted to give sanitary pads to young people who in the rural areas who wanted, you know, who couldn't afford them. But what I failed to understand was that sometimes we need to create platform for young people to start generating something so that they can afford to buy without really receiving from other people. So My pledge is to create a platform for young people to actually generate some form of cash, especially on the entrepreneur side, for them to start some small businesses in trying to establish those through Imagination University, and so that they can be able to afford to buy their own sanitary towels and so on. So that is my pledge. I'm just going to make sure that the girl child's life is much easier as possible, especially in the environment where I'm coming from, which is the rural side of Africa.
Yeah, it's such an important initiative, Vhutali. We're backing you to do it and we're supporting you in any way we can. You're an absolute star. How about you, Philip, over in Youth Island? What's your pledge for the next year? What change are you going to create?
I think ever since exactly a year ago, where I came with 10 others to gather the harvest of 1,000 young people that was then handed over to the UN in a declaration, it gave me this understanding of youth has a voice. People have something to say. They just don't always have the platform to do so. And ever since last year, and what I'm doing right now is just providing that opportunity, that feeling that I got last year, to as many as I possibly can. And I will continue to do that from tomorrow and the day after.
Brilliant. Thanks for that. And I'd love for the remainder of the crew to make their pledges. Maybe we go across to Aart and Martina.
Thank you. My pledge is, I made goals, I would say, for the next year together with my teammates that I live with. So we have different kind of goals that we want to keep. But in simple way to put it, we are all trying to be an example and role models for the younger people, because we are studying to become a teachers. So basically the collective and the group that I live in, I will try to be my best self and try to learn together with them to grow. And just to give a practical example, we decided to not use alcohol and drugs because we want to give example of healthy lifestyle, and we want to be present, I would say. Everyone has different stance about this, but my personal stand is that I want to be present and as much as possible, and I don't need this substances to feel better or distract myself. And then we want to be active for sure and do many projects to connect with people, to learn from them, and to show the world that that's what we can do and inspire other people possibly to do many other things.
Aart?
I want to be a great father and grandfather. And besides that, dedicate my life to bridge gaps. It can be a gap between the have and the have-nots, between black and white, between the gaps, the urgency between, let's say, of what happens now in society needs the bridges. And I want to be a small bridge in that sense.
Brilliant. Thanks, Martina, for being present, and Aart for being a bridge builder. Let's go across to Paris with Olivier.
Well, I guess a bit like Aart, what I've been doing for the last 15 years, and like many of you, is creating these bridges and creating communities and learning communities that collaborate together. So one way for me to do so in the coming months will be to co-organize with hundreds of organizations of all kinds, and really with youth leadership, the Learning Planet Festival, where we want to celebrate everything that people learn, what they want to learn next. We are creating an open pathway. We want to celebrate also mentors from the past across cultures and centuries. So that's a very collective work, and I invite you all to join for sure. We already have conversation with most of you, but that's the festival itself is not a goal. It's a moment where you bring together very diverse community, you mobilize people, and you work on creating a movement around hope, thriving ways of learning, and all these kinds of things. So that's quite strong, because we see real projects emerging from these moments, although often too often online. So this year, hopefully, there will be activities happening in situ also in person.
So incredible. Anne-Marie, I'm going to throw to you. What's your pledge over the next 12 months?
That's a long time, and I like to be following the flow and seeing what needs to happen in the moment. But for now, I can very clearly see, I mean, the red thread is always seeing how we can come together in a heart-centered way of serving. And I love to strategically connect people to see how I can enhance their own capacities. And I want to offer you immediately that we can continue the conversation and to see how I can connect you to any groups, evolutionary leaders, others that are around the world, and where I would say I follow and would also invite all the time people to sense into a deep sense of curiosity, so that we can enhance our capacity to listen as well. So that's my offer here, to continue immediately to see how we can, serve this beautiful work that you do. Thank you so much.
It's really special. I think, there's this one thing that we have at AIM, and it's called Hoodie Economics, and it's not the exchange of money, it's the exchange of time, knowledge, and opportunity. And I think that's one thing that, like, we're all doing and we're all capable of doing, is being able to share that the Hoodie Economics. So thank you. Anna, lucky last, the ball is yours. What is your pledge for the next 12 months, my friend?
Thank you so much. I would like to share my thoughts on this, because as we talked about earlier on, it is also about finding your inner peace. This morning, I participated in an Aikido class where the core value is that you can fight anything if you find your inner peace and use this energy from within yourself. Then you can fight anything and the world. So I believe that if all of us work on ourselves and find our inner peace, then we will be able to show this peace, to use this energy to create more peace around us. And this is something very beautiful, I think, that all of us need to work on in order for us to achieve our goals further from that. That was my thoughts on this. Thank you.
That's brilliant, Anna. I think that brings us to the end of a very power-packed panel. How are we feeling, Drew Patensky? Are we ready to give this a wrap? What is your pledge, Drew?
My pledge, I have too many to be able to riddle them all out, but I think one of the key things that I want to be able to do over the next 12 months is be able to support First Nations communities and grow entrepreneurship. So I don't know what that looks like, but it's definitely something that's intrigued me a lot over the last 12, 24 months, and something that I'm passionate about pushing forward and really driving on self-determination. So somewhere in amongst that, there's a few different key pledges that I'm feeling great, man. I think this has been a really beautiful conversation, and it's definitely not the end of the conversation. I think there's this is a small ripple in a large lake. So man, I'm feeling good. How are you doing?
Yeah, feeling really excited and positively charged for the change that's to come and the change that's required today. And yeah, I'll round us out by saying it is, in a way, tapping into the wisdom that's inherent in all of us. And from where I come from in India, we sort of say, like, peace is the natural state of humankind. It is not something we learn. Perhaps war and violence is something we learn. And in fact, most of the chants or the mantras we have in India often end with the words Om Shanti, Shanti, Shantihi, which means peace, peace, and peace upon the three worlds, which sort of represents all the different universes or all the different worlds that exist at the moment, past, present, future, so on and so forth. So on that note, we will agree with a call to peace, peace, and peace with this amazing power-packed panel from all around the world. Thank you for joining us. Thank you, Drew, for hosting me alongside me. And we'll play the outro and see you all on the other side.